Hello, friends, and welcome to the inaugural episode of Area 312 Rock and Metal Vodcast. I'm one of your hosts, Kent, along with my co-host,
Rex,
and my other co-host,
Mike.
And we are welcoming, it is a privilege to have author, musician, teacher, pastor, member of the first band that ever did hard music with a Christian message, Mr. Glenn Kaiser. Welcome, Mr. Glenn.
My pleasure.
It is an honor and privilege to have you. Friends, Mr. Glenn has graced us today, and we're going to be getting into some of the history of Rez briefly. We don't have time to tackle the almost 30-year history of only Rez, and then, of course, Mr. Glenn's solo material and Glenn Kaiser Band. But we're going to touch on some touchstones of the history, and it was only befitting for us to do this episode. As mentioned, Mr. Glenn and Rez Band, they were the first hard music band with a Christian theme out there. And our vodcast was actually named in honor of one of their songs, Area 312, off the DMZ album. So it was just befitting for us to have Mr. Glenn. Now, Mr. Glenn has a little concert later on today. Want to tell him where you're playing, Mr. Glenn?
Well, a couple of our two youngest, grandkids attend a Christian school about 10 blocks from where we are here in inner city Chicago. And they do a fundraiser every year. Well, they tagged me, and actually my youngest daughter, Amy Moss, has a band called The Unfortunate. And so they tagged me and Amy, her band, to come and do this. We're going to be the music. There's like two groups. And then there's going to be a break, and there'll be a second show later on with a local Christian rapper. I think they've got some dancers and stuff. I don't know. But they're doing this, you know, food and drink and blah, blah, blah. And it's a fundraiser for the Christian school. So I found out about it, actually, only about a month ago. I think it was after we committed to doing this, right? Quite a while after. So I said, well, we'll make it work.
I couldn't help it, friends. When Mr. Glenn said, you know, we messed with the time a little bit to get things arranged, and he said he was performing a gig or a concert for his grandkids at their school, I'm picturing like children's church and all these kids singing Military Man, you know, like children's church. Or can you picture children's church style and the kids singing Defective Youth, if y'all know that song?
Oh, just, gosh. You know?
Anyway, we're going to get into
What's the matter with you? That's a bizarre church.
We also want to get in quickly, friends, so we're going to move along as soon as I shut up, and we'll get rolling with the questions. But Gurr Records has recently re-released a classic Rez Band album, which was Between Heaven and Hell from 1985. So we want to ask Mr. Glenn a few questions about some songs there. So that'll be important. But Mike, I know that the first question you had was one of yours. If you want to get us going, buddy.
Yeah, Glenn, just to tell you a little bit about myself. I also have a YouTube show aside from this one called I Testimony. And basically what I do there is I just talk to basically anybody who will tell me their story about how they came to Jesus and how that came about. And so one of the first things I do whenever I talk to people is I ask them, tell me a little bit about how you grew up and how you came to Jesus. And so that's what I'd like to ask you to start with.
I grew up in the country in rural Wisconsin in the middle of nowhere, farms. There were three major migrations of German immigrants. You look at the phone book back in the day when we had phone books. Now it's online, right? But German names, like crazy, right? And hardworking farmers. And my dad actually got married later in life. He waited till he was 42. In the day, he was a pretty handsome dude and made a lot of money. He was a regional trucker and then became terminal manager of what was then a sort of the roadway trucking company of the day here in Chicago, inner city Chicago. In fact, he lived in a hotel about four blocks from here for years. Got promoted up to Milwaukee and then back to Beaver Dam, Wisconsin, where I'm from originally, where I was born. And we lived in little farm areas all around there. He got to a point where he felt like he was away from the family too much. And I was a third of the kids, third born. And so he quit. He just bailed on it. Started a business, which actually made money the first year. He goes down to the shop one day, and the partner and the money's gone. Safe's empty. Right after that, he got sick, had three operations on his spine, became diabetic, really disabled for quite some time. And it was hunting and fishing and bartering, not like we would do up in Wisconsin for sport, but to eat. So I lived a very different, I often say it's fairly close to a poor Black Southern experience, but I was white in the North. And it was because of illness and no real money or healthcare or options. For about 3 years, we were on welfare. My dad and my older brother and sister, we did everything we could do, pick berries, fish. I ate so much fish, I didn't want to see another fish, potato soup. I didn't realize back then shopping at the resale shop wasn't cool. So but I'm just going to tell you that my background was extremely rural, extremely poor, and not because anybody was lazy or wasn't willing to work or do the effort. In fact, he ended up going back on road construction as soon as he could get well enough physically to get out and do it. My mother committed adultery. She was way concerned about the finances and all. Family blew up. She divorced my dad. I ended up with her in working class suburb Milwaukee, 2 million metro. Time went on. Brother joins the army. Sister got married basically to get out of the house. I could tell you about train wrecks in my family from here to Kingdom Come. At the end of it, I essentially from 13 up, music. First band, first song I wrote. 13. And then for about three and a half years, something like that, I completely blew off white music because the pop music of the day didn't sound honest, didn't sound real. I was hearing cash registers going off when I heard all the songs. And then a Black radio station started up in Wauwatosa, which is another suburb just north of West Allis. And it sounded so gut street. Real honest. Now you got to know, this is Vietnam War time. This is assassinations of the Kennedys and then Martin Luther King Jr. This is the riots all over the country, Kent State. So a lot of death, a lot of destruction, a lot of burning places up. So I can tell you, gentlemen, that I was an activist from an early age, though I completely get, and I hunt, when I can. I don't have much time and I don't want to commit to it too much to it, but I fish. I'm going to say, I could probably live in the woods tomorrow and not even think twice about it. But the inner city and the pain and the struggle and what was there are a lot of connecting dots, but what I saw in rural struggle with farmers and farms and farming, I was in Northern Illinois 15 years ago, a guy was selling his last dozen dairy cattle and sitting there crying. Now you wouldn't know all this from Rez Band. You wouldn't get all this from these lyrics, but you got to understand my whole perspective is completely rural and completely inner city where I am right now. I'm a chaplain. I do tons of work in Cook County Jail for many years. I'm accredited in Illinois out of Stateville, which is probably the third nastiest prison. I've been all over Ohio many times with a chaplain friend of mine, death row all over. I had a friend, by the way, in Illinois, executed on death row before the moratorium. So I have lived in such a way has to constantly be connected with little towns in the middle of nowhere to major urban areas. And then, of course, in the world, with res tours, blues tours, I've done solo concerts, you name it. So I don't care if it's 30 people or, you know, in England, we had 35,000 at Greenbelt during the res set. So, but I'm happy in front of 20 people in a prison. I understand, I think, from studying history, but also from personal experience, the struggles that people go through. And so when people start rattling, you know, I've been an independent voter pretty much my whole life, but I've also been very much of an activist. And I find that too many people don't face the fact that we are literally between heaven and hell. We're not, if you follow Jesus, you know him in a personal way, you're born again, you really, really follow Jesus. I mean, follow. He didn't say pray a prayer. He said, follow me. Teach us to pray. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God's will, not mine, not the church's will. And I speak as a pastor in an ordained church, an ordained pastor in a denomination even. Right? So there's my preach, but that sets you up for whatever else you want to ask, and I'll try to be more brief in the answers.
Can you briefly say what the event was, or if there was an event that brought you to Christ?
Yeah, so I was 18, well, 2 weeks before my 18th birthday. I was essentially an alcoholic. We're right on the edge of it. I did every drug, every way you could do it, literally, every chance I had, except run up needles. I wouldn't shoot. And I was right at the edge of shooting heroin. I was right there. I pretty much decided I was going to run up smack and just call it a day, you know. 2 weeks before my 18th birthday. Now, up there in Wisconsin, some sweet little gray-haired ladies hauled me off to a vacation Bible school when I was like five or six. About six sessions. Every kid had to memorize something. They gave me John 3:16. Long story short, after going all through this mess, horrible trips, freaking paranoia off the charts, hating myself, hating everybody, three bands and two girlfriends at the same time, all this mess, had come back out of blues and R&B and soul music into full-blown rock. God showed up in about four months, beyond that, but it was packed in about a four-month shot. And it's way too long to get into it all. I've written a book on it. It'll eventually be published. But so that night, it's like, who are you? I literally stood in my mom's kitchen at 3 a.m. My uncle, my godfather, had just died. I could see the hearse parked in the driveway, kitty corner from ours. I could look into their driveway. And I'm, you know, I'd almost died. I'd been through all this mess. And I knew I was an addict and a train wreck and a small-time dope dealer messing other people up, using girls for sex. I mean, the whole thing. So I was just a wreck. And I hated it, and I couldn't stop. No control. Addiction. It's a killer. And I knew he was trying to speak to me. He had done it in so many ways. I break down and I say, who are you and what are you trying to say? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten. I mean, John 3:16 flashed through my head after all those years. And I literally broke down and wept. Well, I did that about six times in my life until then. You know, you couldn't break me. You just, you know. And I took about 3 seconds, which I wrote a song called 3 Seconds, alluding to that. I break down and I ask forgiveness. And I'm like, this is the worst one-sided deal I ever heard of. You're getting ripped off. You get garbage, you get dirt on a stick, and I get forgiveness and eternal life and love and acceptance. I mean, I understood it in a split second. And I hadn't thought of that verse in all those years. That's the night that I really came to saving faith. About 3 a.m, it happened to be January the 3rd, 1971. Now, 9 months later, I began to really follow. So there's a little video book up that Gurr Records has put up on YouTube. Before I shaved my, called Now What? Yeah. And it talks about that first 9 months. That it wasn't, and some things I was instantly delivered, shocking me and my friends. in fact, some of my friends were like, "What's up with you?" I didn't notice. But then other things, to really follow Jesus as Lord, not just Savior. And that's the continual path for all of us, isn't it? So, but that's how I came to know him in really what in seminary speak, saving faith. I want to give myself to you, Jesus. I got some problems I want to talk to you about now.
Mr. Glenn, when you were talking about a forthcoming book being published on that, and I am familiar, as I know that Mike and I believe Rex too, we are familiar with the Now What series on YouTube that's currently out there. And incidentally, friends, I will post the link to that, to the Girl Records Now What series featuring Mr. Glenn. He's basically giving his autobiography. Mr. Glenn, yes. Is that the book that you're speaking about? Are you going to put that in a hard book format?
Yeah, well, every time it, well, first of all, Now What, I don't know if it's ever going to go to print. Maybe we'll print it, but we don't know. We're not sure. So, but the other book that I alluded to, that's essentially my testimony, you know, way beyond what we can do here. It's chapter after chapter of how God knocked on my door, like in Technicolor. Like, I mean, honestly, I hear some of these stories from others, and I have for many years. The Jesus movement days, God showed up when we were high, when we were straight. I mean, Jesus, not everybody gets that kind of boom, you know? And we were so thick and so full of dope, a lot of us needed it, I guess. So, you know, but that book is probably going to be called Every Time It Rains, which is alluded to the song Every Time It Rains, which is really, that's one of the chapters. I won't go into that, but so yeah, maybe that'll be in print. We've talked a lot about getting somebody to edit. Now What even needs more editing before it would go to print. Gerhard asked me to read it out. I said, if you're going to do an audio book, let's just go ahead and do a video thing and throw it up on YouTube in the Ger channel. So Ger Records is, you know, G, three R's and fourth R on records. And there's a fifth in records. Records. Anyway, so yeah, that Between Heaven and Hell. Obviously, we're not in hell, though some of us might think we are, and the way some people, the way their life is. This isn't it yet. That's for real sure. And Jesus talked about all that. And then we're not in heaven yet, though some of us would like to pretend we are, or, you know, in Britain, they would talk about the happy clappies, you know. Hallelujah, everything's wonderful all the time. And I'm like, what world do you live in? What world do you live in? You believe in fairies as well, do you? Trolls under the bridge.
You were talking about Between Heaven and Hell, Mr. Glenn, and we'll segue into this album here, if you don't mind. And I'd like to go back. There's some touchstones about the band's history I'd really like to get into if we have time. What was the catalyst for the name chosen for the 1985 album Between Heaven and Hell? What made Rez say, hey, this is the title?
Well, I mean, the general concept, it unfolds song for song for song, right? Just what's there in the lyrics. But I mean, the concept was, I just said it, Christians often live in this almost make-believe that we're somehow in spiritual nonstop bliss. Which is not true. It's never been true. It isn't true. And on the other hand, you know, I mean, the biggest category of lyrics in the Book of Psalms are laments for a reason. Right. And that's the hymnal of Israel. That's the worship book of Israel. So we're between heaven and hell. And transitions are often the most difficult with the pandemic now and the political extreme polarization. People having to face up to the history of this nation. This is not comfortable. Now the Holy Spirit, who's the comforter, also convicts of sin, righteousness, and judgment. He, you know, he makes us supremely comfortable, but he also super convicts and discomforts us all. Me and, you know, me too. You know, so that was the gist of it. I mean, between heaven, this is where we are right now. And of course, that's timeless. We could have done that album today. And lyrically, thematically, that's until Jesus comes again, until this world is rolled up like a scroll, as the book of Hebrews says, this is where we are.
Right. You hit on something, Mr. Glenn. You know, I'm good about remembering scripture, but I'm really bad about pinpointing it. But I do recall distinctly the Lord Jesus saying, in this world, you will have trouble.
Yep, tribulation.
But be of good cheer.
I've overcome the world.
That's right.
But now is not then. Now we see through a glass darkly, then face to face. Then is not now. Now is not then.
Right.
And it's that in between that a lot of us, you know, we chafe at it. Mm-hmm. Some people argue that that's part of what God uses to draw people to Himself, and I think there's some truth in that. It's a tough thing to chew, but I think there's truth in there.
Sure, sure. Mr. Glenn was, you know, just kind of doing some research and everything. Is it true that I've read somewhere that Between Heaven and Hell was geared more toward the mainstream market? Was that kind of like a specific focus?
Well, yeah. I'll try to keep this super condensed. We had a manager in-house for a time who had gotten to know some of the U2's North American management. He got to know a number of people. Bruce Coburn, which I'd gotten to know him before the manager did, but the Alarm, Mike Peters, number of people. And the manager, he had a burden and a vision to try to get us to get more into the mainstream. We said, we prayed about it, we thought it through, we'll give it a shot. I mean, we've been doing what we've been doing for years, we're gonna continue to do, we are who we are. Long story short, we signed with DMA, which was out of Detroit. They were, Ted Nugent and a bunch of other people at the time, touring them all over the country. We did some showcases for universities. We picked up a number of tours where we ended up, everybody who's in, like ZZ Top, for example, would have played a lot of the venues we played on the way up. So it's kind of a medium. It wasn't an entry level. It was a more of a medium level thing. So we went on. Now in those situations, I didn't preach at the end. I didn't say much like I had for some years in Rez Band. The lyrics were pretty out front. Everybody knew we were Christians. It was easy enough to find out who we were and what we were about. We had enough history and, you know, all these albums. But there were a number of open doors. Now, I ended up night after night, as the whole band, we always did this. Yeah, I'd be soaking wet after the set, put a towel around my neck, get a Diet Coke, and sit down in the club at a table, ask somebody, you know, if these, and it's like, what, you rock stars, you can't do this. Well, we're doing it, you know, and, you know, whatever, how you doing, dude? I'm Glenn. Yeah, blah, blah, blah. We sit down and we chat for a while. And, you know, we met so many messed up, hurting, and backslidden Christians, by the way, by the ton. And that was then, all over the country. So, we did a couple, two or three tours. We were with U2's North American management for about 3 months. All they said was Wendy should drop the top and hike up the skirt. Which we laughed and said, that isn't going to happen. And Wendy was just like,
yeah, that chance.
You know, and they said, you know, you really shouldn't be going out into the audience after the gig. You know, like, yeah, well, you know, we politely said, sit in the trees and watch, you know, we love you, but we're hiring you. You're not hiring us. And cool. They were totally cool. They'd come to a couple of our shows and had nothing. I mean, I think genuinely, yeah, because they'd had enough of a witness from, you know, a couple of the dudes in U2 as well. And mm-hmm. And so I think they thought, okay, well, these people are who they are. And but we amicably parted after just 3 months. Well, this album came out right about that time. It was all sort of in the same sphere.
Gotcha. Mr. Glenn, I'd just like to touch base on a couple songs, especially from Between Heaven and Hell, if you don't mind. Three songs. Love Comes Down.
Yeah. Well, when you lose, you win. That's the way it is. If you lose your life for my sake and the sake of the gospel, you'll find it. You try to gain your life. You write the script. You're your own, you know, you're your own author, your own director, your own screenplay writer. You're going to be a false deity. You lose your life for your life, your design, your plans. Exchange, trust me, and watch what I do. And that's really the whole concept.
Some of the lyrics, the wordplay in here, he's the love enforcer and he has paid your bail. She was playing in traffic and you were scoping her out. She was so much elastic. Someone had strung her out. I mean, incredible wordplay. Mr. Glenn, the lyrics and all throughout the duration of Rez, and even now with your solo, do the lyrics come easily, or how long does it take for you to craft lyrics for a song on average?
I mean, sometimes 5 minutes, sometimes five edits over a period of, you know, a few weeks or a month or whatever. And of course, a number of the earlier albums, I wrote it all, but thank God as time went on, you know, Jim came through with some great song. Well, even then early, but more and more as time went on. And then Roy, same thing. And then everybody chimed in, and John Trott, dear friend of mine, number of lyric writers, people mainly in the community here at Jesus People that we know well and know us and have a heart. But you know, even as you recite those lyrics there and Love Comes Down, from day one, Broken Promises on the first album, on Awaiting Your Reply, I don't think entirely as a Christian when I'm writing. I think as a atheist or agnostic, I think when I was an unbeliever, those first 18 years, trust me, I was about as far from God as you could get without doing a Saul, you know, before he became Paul. I just ignored, I don't even know if I met any real Christians in those years. And so, you know, there's a few ladies up in Wisconsin there, but it was just like the real world is not always what the church tells you it is. And the real world is not what unbelievers or pre-believers or, you know, non-Christians will tell you it is. But I have come to believe decades ago, all truth is God's truth. So the delivery of those lyrics, the delivery of that truth. I mean, tonight I'm not going to say a whole lot, and there'll be a bunch of folks there that don't know the Lord. Not everybody that attends church knows Jesus, and not everybody who shows up at a function like this. But my set, you know, I'm doing an Otis Redding tune, and I'm doing a couple of covers from R.L. Burnside and Son House, but those are like in your face old time gospel lyrics. So, but I'm a blues guy, so I kind of get away with it, right? So it's one of those things where how do I best connect with that individual or those even those few people that may show up in a particular show or sit at home or in their car, you know, listen to the music, or, you know, laying in bed at night, coming out of whatever the pain, the issue is in their life. How do I best connect? So, you know, I think and speak still a street as much as I ever do. In fact, I'm way more comfortable. I mean, to be honest, thank God I don't have to hardly ever wear a suit coat. I have one suit jacket that I, God have mercy on us all. I know, I got three ties, I think, maybe two. And I know how to tie them. And I can tuck my ponytail in and do a straight church thing. You know, I do it from time to time. But the average person, that's not who they are. And so in reaching out to people that we were dealing with in Res and that I deal with now in blues shows or bikers shows or even on the street here on Wilson Avenue, sitting out front, they don't give a rip about any of that stuff.
Right.
So how do I connect? So the lyrics, you know, she was so much elastic. Someone had strung her out. Man, I can't even tell you how many girls I knew like that back in the day and how many women we've seen and men in the history of our ministry here. So in Chicago, so it's just all over the world, you know.
Real, Mr. Glenn, we'll move on to another song, but just for the record, and I almost hate to ask this, but I want to nip this in the bud, and you're the source, and I want some people to hear this. I have seen some have compared the main riff to Love Comes Down to Whole Lotta Rosie by AC/DC.
Oh, yeah.
My contention is that there's a lot of songs out there in the world, and sometimes things happen to kind of, you know, for the record, was that song influence or not?
Yeah, no, actually, there, because of all the touring and traveling, there is a possibility that I heard that song, A Whole Lot of Rosie, at a gas station or something, you know, going in to get coffee and paying for the gas. Maybe. If I would, I would have only heard a little bit of the riff.
Right.
In those days, well, even now, I don't hardly listen to music. And when I do, it's old Smithsonian blues stuff from the 20s and 30s, largely country blues players, and then sometimes more modern stuff, Rory Gallagher and stuff. But you know, so it might have somehow got in there. And then I ended up writing that riff and that vibe, but I had never consciously known about the song, heard of the song, nor did I ever listen to that song ever until after somebody raised that some months after the album was out and released and we were touring it. So, yeah.
Well, you know, and we have to remember, these are the days when people weren't wearing their iPods or whatever they're called, you know. Mike, I know you had a question about Shadows.
Yeah, so with the song Shadows, which obviously is a great song, beloved by many, I was curious whether or not there were actual events that inspired that song.
No. Many situations that we knew about and, you know, that we heard of from people. I will tell you that I think it might have been a week after the album was released. We were playing, Rez was doing a tour, and I think we were in Ohio maybe, but it was at a high school that night. They booked a high school auditorium, and turned out to be a good show. A lot of people showed up, but we get in there, we do our sound check, and there were like three, four kids. One had just graduated, and the other three were seniors in that high school, and we were pretty, you know, we had our road manager and our crew, you know, let people in, we don't care, let people in, blah, blah, blah. So somehow they were in, and because they were part of the school, they popped in, and sound check was over, they approached us, and two of them looked like they'd just gotten punched in the face, and the one who was speaking was just saying, "We just got your album, and we couldn't believe it. Because exactly what you wrote about, the way you wrote about it in that song, in Shadows, happened at this high school in the woods behind the building you're playing in here tonight. Mm-hmm. How did you know?" You know, so it's one of the, Well, God, the Holy Spirit knew that. Wow. You know, wow. What do you, I mean, what do you say to that? That right. kind of stuff happens. I won't say it happens daily or even yearly, but it happens a whole lot over the span of our time is me personally, Rez, you know, GKB and all the rest of it. So yeah, that was powerful. Well, we, you know, suicide, if anything, is worse now than then. I was up in Alaska, Rez did a couple tours, and I've done solo tours up there. I did one last year and played a bunch of penitentiaries as well, which was just, oh, I can't wait. Lord willing, I'll be back up there again. But the Native Alaskan population, many of the minority populations, situations where there's a lot of poverty among white folks as well, even affluent families. Suicide is, you know, it just keeps on going up and up. And then with the pandemic and, you know, it just the burdens of life. So we had to do a song about it.
One of that's one of the beautiful things about Rez is that one of the hallmarks of Rez, Mr. Glenn, is that you all, not only was there the Lord Jesus loves you and gave his life for you and he rose and you know, he comes to give you abundant life, but one of the hallmarks of Rez is that you all actually touched on so many socio-political topics. You know, from suicide, and you know, I'm thinking about so many topics like, you know, Concert for a Queen. That's such a beautiful song about intimacy between husband and wife.
And a harmony is a concert for the king. Well, we are his royal children, and he provides the love we exchange when I feel the touch of your hand upon.
Y'all sung about drug addiction. Y'all sang about decrying social injustice and bigotry. And Mr. Glenn, one of the songs I wanted to ask you about, I know that Rez has written two songs against apartheid, and please help me with my pronunciation. The first song was Afrikaans. Is that, am I pronouncing that right? Is that how?
I didn't catch the last, I was following you to the last little bit there.
Okay. If I'm pronouncing it right, the first song against apartheid, was it pronounced Afrikaans? Is that how it's?
Yeah, Afrikaans. It's that was on
Rainbow's End. Rainbow's End.
Awaiting your reply. I had Between Heaven and Hell stuck in a loop in my brain. That the first album, and then Zuid Afrikaans, which was on Rainbow's End, the second Rez album.
Yes.
It turned out that we wrote Afrikaans and put that album out about a year before Peter Gabriel's Biko.
Right.
So, we didn't know that. Sometime later, somebody said the first, you know, sort of rock song that dealt with the issue was done by this bizarre Christian band, right? So, Well, my best friend from third grade up, he would like to deny it, to be honest with you. Not that he was my best friend or anything, but his mama was full-blooded Hawaiian, very black, very dark. His sister, you thought sure she was African-American, and his mom. His dad was Irish, but had dark, thick, curly hair. And we were out in the sun all the time in the summer. And, you know, he was my best buddy from the third grade till graduate. We did dope together. I had the same girlfriend for a while. I mean, you know, did I say we weren't Christians?
We shared everything.
but I saw how he got treated. And growing up in the 60s where I was, man, did I get an education. And then Marion, a preacher's daughter, who, when integration was laid down as an absolute, not just in law, but by the United Methodists in South Carolina, where her daddy was a pastor in a little town. Let's just say that I've learned an awful lot about racism and prejudice, and I've hated it from day one. And you know. Okay, if I'm an old hippie leftist liberal, so be it. I don't really give a rip. I am who I am. Jesus is who Jesus is. I look at the scripture and I look at the way Christians play games with these things. So, you know, those songs had to happen. Somebody who loved Jesus and was serious about scripture, about the word of God, we have to have not only the brains, but the heart and the guts to say these things. So, yeah, I mean, to me, it was just a natural to talk about what I'd grown up looking. I mean, in first and second grade in Lily White, Fox Lake, Wisconsin, there were two black families. I have no idea how they got there. This is out in the country, and it's a little town, 1,181, dinky little town. I shot marbles with a couple of the young black kids they were in my class. If you were black and had freckles and had curly hair, I thought you were cool. If you weren't one of the penguin pop bottles. So, I mean, God made me a missionary, you know, set me up before I ever came to know him. I mean, really follow Jesus. But it's the fear, it's the ignorance. I heard that all over the South. Beginning the tour way back when with Rez Band. They're just ignorant. You know, the word prejudiceum comes from the Latin. Prejudiceum, the word, it's where we get prejudice. The absolute core etymology of that word, the core meaning is vacuum packed, you know, ignorance, and still you make a judgment on a person or a people group. What is there to not understand?
Right.
I mean, that's the issue. And that issue has to be raised from a lot of angles, and I'm not going to quit raising it.
So, you know, Mr. Glenn, along that lines, you know, my eyes were open to the issue through your song many years ago. It was in the early 90s when I first heard Afrikaans. And, you know, the line, God makes the color, but the color doesn't make you God. And that's such a classic line. And I'm not trying to get any, for our viewers out there, friends, to me, this is not anything political. This is about truth. And here's what I mean. And Mr. Glenn, let me just see what you think. Genesis 1:27. So God created mankind. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Mr. Glenn, that speaks to me that God, the God of all creation, all of humanity was created in his image. And I just don't understand at face value why people can't get it.
I was at a conference a number of years ago in the Evangelical Covenant Church, which is I'm ordained with, and Jesus People is a member church of, small denomination, Protestant denomination. Super on missions, super. Super on commitment to scriptures, centrality of the word of God. So I don't know, the preacher was going on. He stopped for a second And he had made a point that related to what a friend of mine said. Bro, I just met him at the conference that day. He leans over to me, and it very much connected with what the preacher had been saying in that break where he didn't say anything for a few seconds. He leans in over and whispers in my ear, you know, God created us in his own image. And we keep trying to return the favor. I about fell off my chair. I had to stifle laughter in this big room full of preachers. I mean, it's just, look, if you got one of these here, and if you're this skin color, and if you got one of these, and you like real deal blues and barbecue, Bubba, you know, then you can be one of us. And the whole point is we want you to be one of us. Well, guess what? Jesus didn't, even on this earth in human form, look like this.
That's right. He was a Jew. He was Jewish. And we're all Gentiles.
And then you got skin pigmentation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So really a different culture.
Right.
And subculture. And you just keep going. And it just, I look at all that stuff and I'm like, all you got to do is swallow hard, humble yourself. How do you apply God's word, the Bible? And I'm talking Genesis 1:1 to the end of Revelation. How do you reconcile that when the whole focus is, if you're not like me, or you're not like us, or you're not like our group, so you got to do church like this, methodology. I'm telling you, I've seen more church splits over the, I'm 68 years old, y'all. I've been doing this since I was 18, all over the world, okay? I have seen more splits over methodology in the church any day than I even have over doctrine or real theology, the nature of God himself. The last seven words of a dying church, we never did it this way before. That mentality, if it was just among people that didn't know the Lord, that didn't really honestly follow Jesus, okay, yeah. What did you expect? It's the tough part is when Christians, professing Christians, it's not about little Christ making disciples, teaching them to observe whatsoever he's commanded us. It's what I command you and what our group commands you. And you know, you have to swallow the whole enchilada and the silverware and the plates, you know. And you wonder why people, and especially younger people, are saying, that's it, we're done. You know, you guys talk about love and you don't love each other. You don't even like each other. You don't even want to be in the same building for an hour or two on Sunday together. You know, you got four churches in the same intersection and they don't hardly talk to each other. What's that all about?
Is that why, Mr. Glenn, there's something that's kind of coming out now? And, you know, I don't want to deep dive into this and we'll kind of round out the, I know we need to get you to the proverbial church on time, but I'm seeing a lot of discussion right now about ex-evangelical.
Yeah.
And do you feel that some of these, the way that we are acting as the church, is that what's causing some people probably to,
I will answer for myself personally. I have so many friends, hard right, hard left. When I came to know Jesus, again, 2 weeks before my 18th birthday, I won't name it, but I went to a well a huge denomination, well respected throughout most of the country, even among other Christians that don't agree with them. Dry, dead as the Sahara. I was so happy that to know the Lord. A block over is basically their competition. Now, these two denominations are probably closer alike each other than any other of the denominations. And one was Protestant and the other was Catholic. Now, did I hear crazy doctrine from, well, I would have heard crazy doctrine from either one of them, to be honest with you. And I figured that out pretty within the first year of my walk with the Lord. But so I'm reading the scriptures every day, pouring through the word, man, like just 10 chapters a day, slow, prayerfully, you know, and I'm going to this huge denominational fellowship, a complete little hole in the wall independent fellowship on Sunday night, and a midweek Bible study at a third large denomination group. Now, the Bible study was probably the most doctrinally basic teaching. The little Sunday night service, half the people were, they're packed out young people, Jesus movement days, but half of them were sleeping with each other, okay? Some of the wackiest stuff I've ever heard taught came from some of those guys, the elders on the Sunday night. Now, the songs and the worship time and the sense, the physical sense of the presence of the Holy Spirit, I don't just mean endorphins either, off the charts. Well, I didn't realize till later on, there's all kinds of mess going on here, you know, morally. But then this big honking behemoth had a group of the most on fire, loving, genuine, full of life believers. Both from, there were three leaders. One, I don't know, I mean, I don't have a copy of the Lamb's Book of Life. He may or may not have been a Christian. The other two, there's no question they were. And they were so gracious and loving and kind. And I rarely heard any bogus teaching come out of them. And then there was a group of women involved in that fellowship. And here comes a long-haired, clean, but a long-haired hippie, barefoot. They never questioned me. Glenn, so glad to see you. They hug my, you know, give me a hug and welcome me. And there were things going on I didn't agree with in all three of these groups. This is my introductory course of discipleship as a believer. And then I bumped into these Jesus freaks downtown Milwaukee, that the core of what found the foundation of Jesus People USA, which is here in Chicago. Well, and they had Lutherans, Baptists, Catholics, Episcopalians, I can go down this long, Pentecostals, you know, Moody grads, teaching from all around Metro Milwaukee. They invited people that they knew, really knew the Lord. They knew we weren't all going to agree with everybody on everything. But we also knew that most of us were only about a year or even 2 years spiritually in walking with Jesus. And so it couldn't just be in-house teaching and discipleship and ministry going on in the community at Jesus People of Milwaukee. It's the right kind of ecumenism. There isn't ecumenism, ecumenical, the broad capital C church and the little churches coming together, that's right. How many Orthodox churches do you think there are? How many kinds of Catholic churches? How many popes to the Protestants do we pro? How many Protestant churches are there? There shall be splits and splits of splits, right? And come on. I learned so much of that within the first 6-7 months of my walk with the Lord. I'm like 18 years old and I'm clueless, right? But it was so obvious. Who is serious about Jesus? Who loves their neighbor? It's one thing for the Lord to make a narrow gate. It's another thing for me or the Christian church to, you know, how much more narrow can we make it, you know, to exclude people that we don't like or that we're afraid of or that we're afraid it's going to get on us. I get it. Look, I've got kids and grandkids. You don't think I'm a grandpa now. You don't think I understand assimilation and syncretism and all that? I do. Straight answer. To me, evangel. The evangel is the good news of Jesus Christ, which includes Matthew 25, food, clothing, housing, as much as it ever does, John 3, 16 and 17, and the Roman road, Romans 8. I mean, I could go on for days. I don't really care what you call yourself or don't. I don't care about the label. I don't care. That's not a hill I'm willing to die on. Now, I've got friends, ex-evangelicals. And I'll say, usually one-on-one, I don't usually get in their face in, you know, in social media, but I will say one-on-one. So, evangel, the good news, the gospel of Jesus, the core truth about salvation in Jesus, you don't have a problem with that, do you? No. You have a problem with the way elements of one larger gathering, in name at least, or with title, of the church is going about doing things these days. That's the issue, right? Yes. I'm not going to argue. I met folks that probably were as in true saving faith as Apostle Paul in all of those churches from day one of my walk with the Lord and throughout this world. And complete knuckleheads, clueless as could be. And folks that had no real, they were just interested, open. So they showed up. And maybe they showed up every Sunday and Wednesday night, you know, whatever. I've met people that are more mature and in real relations with Jesus at 18 than at 80. And I met people that were in the church all their life, 80 years old, who absolutely get it. They love God. They love their neighbor. They're dealing with how to relate to their enemies, whom Jesus has commanded us to love. So even the issue, let's go one step further, social gospel. Matthew 25, separate the sheep from the goats. Well, we can say forget John, but if you're forgetting John, you might as well forget Matthew, Mark, Luke, and everything. If you're going to cherry pick, don't tell these old liberal yahoos from cherry picking when you're cherry picking. Jesus mentions food, water, clothing, housing. He mentions health. And he mentions prisoners, which is about as far out from the others as you can think of. Everybody deals with the first four daily. Have to. Matter of survival. Now, maybe you're going to steal or do something you shouldn't do if you're sick or your kids are sick or your spouse is sick and you're dirt poor. Maybe you're going to do a little shine up in the mountains of West Virginia, or you're going to sell dope or guns in the inner city. Come on. You want to get at it? Let's get at it. So you got food, water, clothing, housing, and healthcare. Maybe you'll end up in prison if you don't have some of those inadequate opportunity to get them. So that's why we have the largest shelter on the north side of Chicago. That's why we got 90 to 100 low-income seniors on the top three floors of our building here where I live. We all live. I mean, you know, 80% of our church lives together and serves in ministry full-time, day after day. Right. Does everybody agree with us? Of course not. We don't all agree with each other on everything. What planet do you live on? You know, do everybody in your family who professes to be a Christian love one another, agree with each other all the time? So instead of the humility factor, we freak out, man. You know, I don't know about y'all, but I got a safety on all my guns. In fact, legally, when you come out of the woods in Illinois in the deer woods with a bow, legally, as soon as the day ends, you got to put a zip tie on the strings on a compound bow, or in my case would be a recurve or a longbow back in the day. Mm-hmm. I mean it's just so yeah, the labels. and different racial discrimination and segregation, but also economic prejudice. The haves versus the have-nots. You say, well, the politicians are trying to divide us. They don't have to do nothing. We're doing it ourselves. We do it in the church. We do it among other churches, other Christians. What are you talking about? So let's cut to the chase. What is truth? You said it. You nailed it. I read it again last night, John 17. Jesus himself said in John 17, in the prayer for the disciples, this is eternal life. To know you, this is Jesus praying. He's talking to the Father. God the Son comes down. And by God the Holy Spirit, he says, this is eternal life, to know you, the only true God. Now that's exclusivity, but it's exclusivity coming out of Jesus' mouth. Mm-hmm. Or maybe John was a knucklehead, or, you know, it's all myth, or it got messed up in the translation over the years because all these different people, you know. We can go on for days with all that cha-cha. Yeah. This is you, the only true God, right? In salvation, eternity, eternal life, to know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Those are Jesus' own words. So that's where I'm at. You can call me anything you like. I mean, you call me a four-letter. I've been called all kinds of things, man. I don't particularly care.
Well, Mr. Glenn, you know, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And he is the narrow road. And there's no denying that, because that's the truth. And I say that because of what history has shown and what, you know, research, historical and scientific and all. I've had to go on a spiritual journey and question my faith some years ago. And,
well, does the church need reformation? Of course it does.
Right.
It always does. You know, I mean, what is salvation, right? One way of looking at your own personal, okay, I believe in Jesus. Right. I'm going to follow you. That's the beginning of reformation. Mm-hmm. Now, reformation, because all change is perceived as loss, that's not scriptural, but it's a true reality in life, in living. So when changes come, should we just carte blanche accept them all and say, that's all wonderful? That's all, you know, we want to say biblical. Well, you mean biblical, what does that mean? How you mean your interpretation or mine of what that means, I mean, about that particular issue?
Right.
I mean, but this is the lack of understanding, both of humility and a deep dive into what's called exegesis in the Bible. You excavate what's there. You don't eisegete. I bring a position and look for stuff to back me up in my own prejudice,
right,
and my own comfort zone.
Right.
Rez Band and myself, we want to comfort. I mean, it's like the Holy Spirit wants to comfort us, but it comes with crosses, you know, and dying to self and repentance and confession of sin and what God in his own word, what Jesus calls sin. Start there. So people want to argue with me about truth. I'm like, what did Jesus say about truth? Start with the four Gospels. Just do a simple word study. Bible, you can go online right now. Truth in the four Gospels. How often does it show up? Go into the Greek. Look at the context. That's what I think.
And what I was going to say, Mr. Glenn, was that, you know, Jesus is the narrow road. But he's like this bright, brilliant neon sign glowing for everybody saying, here am I, I'm drawing all men into myself, you know. And so that's kind of that's what I was going to say, you know.
Whosoever will shall come.
Right.
That by all means, yeah. Paul said, I might save some. I mean, he didn't literally mean all, like, we're not talking about violation of scripture. We're not talking throw your ethics out the window. Right. The problem is that we have these, they're just human constructs that are so, you know, and I mean, this is a hill I'm going to die on. Well, you're probably going to die then, and you'll probably take some people down with you. I mean, because sooner or later, you're going to run into somebody, and it may be Jesus, who doesn't fit your paradigm. He didn't do it like us, man. Look at the book of Acts. Good grief. Look at Acts 2 and 4. You want to talk about it. If there's any template, they met daily in the temple where they were known as the biggest cult in the land at the time, or the newest cult, meeting with a bunch of Jews who just got through crucifying their Lord and Savior, right? They met daily in the temple courts and from house to house, both and. Sue and I went swimming in the U.S. Virgin Islands at the end of a res tour. We had one of these Eastern Airlines, which is now defunct. You could fly anywhere for a month for like 400 and some bucks. So we booked an entire tour. That was nuts. It was great, but it was crazy. Well, there was 2 extra days. So we had about 50 bucks between us. So we flew to the Virgin Islands and we go snorkeling, and neither one of us had ever seen the coral, you know, live coral like that in the ocean on the beach. And we both came up about swallowing the ocean, you know, like, look at all these, the coral and then the fish. And it's like, you know, I mean, God created all kinds of folks, y'all. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean everything all kinds of folks do, whether they're followers of Jesus or not, whether they're involved in the local church or they're knuckleheads out there trying to run around like the Lone Ranger. I mean, it doesn't. Mm-hmm. Love one another. Serve one another. Forgive. Yeah, he wants us to agree with one another. But I don't find in scripture or in life or in the history of the larger church, the whole capital C church on earth. We have in part, in that chapter on love in 1 Corinthians 13, Paul nails it. Mm-hmm. So obviously there's going to be debates over how to do church, how to do ministry, how to disciple people, what real evangelism looks like, how to be faithful as a citizen of this country or that country. What do you do with this issue or that issue, you know? I'm probably about 98% left and have been since I was 15. That's just the truth. I know there are things to say at just the right time. I know the right people to be with, and my praise is always right. Oh, it's right. My life, if the core motive in my life is not relation to Jesus and what God says in his own word, and I mean, get into the four gospels, get into Matthew 25, deal with Micah 6:8, go through the New Testament letters. You know, people want to dump Paul all the time. I think, yeah, well, is it because he's not convenient? You know, he's not going to kiss up to your cultural desire when that's really what it boils to.
Yes, sir.
You're not taking your cues from God or the scripture. You're taking your cues from the culture. But so does the straight conservative church. too often, not all the time, not in every area.
Well, if I can just say, Glenn, I would probably identify myself as 98% right most of the time.
That's fine, whatever.
But yet at the same time, I hold all the exact same convictions you just talked about as far as helping the poor and the needy and everything else. So I think it's all just a matter of perspective, you know, maybe on how best to accomplish those things, but.
And perspective, mine or yours, perspective does not equal the word and mind and will of God.
Well, right. But the word of God tells us, here are the things you should do as a Christian. This is who you are. This is what you should do. And, you know, whether somebody considers themselves right like me or more left like you, if we still have those same goals and we live our lives for those purposes, I don't think it matters how we label ourselves.
After a while, you begin to realize that the most crucial thing on earth has never been a political position.
Right. Yeah.
But it will get, like in this town, whoo. The second we started reaching out to the poor, the ripoff politicians had us on their radar. Because now we influence, and it may affect the vote and their constituency.
Sure.
And their job, it's not their job, not everybody else's jobs or whether they get have one or have opportunity for one, their job and their power and the money that they're making and want to make, their political career. So we couldn't be apolitical. We couldn't divorce ourselves from the reality of what was going on. And, you know, I often tell people, you know, you guys elect and reelect your own corrupt politicians in Illinois. We send them to prison. We do. A pile of them are sitting in prison or just got out. You know what I mean? I mean, this is, we in the world you shall have, you were quoting it, tribulation. You know, there.
Well, and that's kind of the thing. You see, I don't put my trust in any politicians, whether they be right or left. You know, I have things that I believe in that are important.
Sure.
That I want to support.
Of course.
And it just, that's what plays out, but.
Wait a minute, that's not about salvation? Wait a minute, my vote isn't salvific?
Oh, no.
No.
Well, I'm just going to make a couple comments, and I had emailed Glenn yesterday, which was just made my year, actually. But and I know Glenn, just grace, and I understand. What I want to say is, from a fan's point of view, or and a Christian's point of view, your lyrics and how you guys presented yourselves, they were authentic and real. We talked a little bit about this earlier. You know, sometimes the church, they don't want to deal with real issues and whatnot. And your lyrics dealt with a lot of this stuff that sometimes you get inside the church and it's rose-colored stained glass window, you know, type of things. And then with your Jesus People USA organization, you like, you know, you walk the talk, you know. And I always appreciated that you were more than just a band. You were actually being true Christians, as how the New Testament talks about, with, like you're saying, the five things: food, clothing, shelter, prisons, you know, that sort of thing. Six. Okay.
So it's all right. I just,
you know, like I said, you just knew that you guys were the real thing, you know, and just, you know, you were just giving it all to God and glory to Him. And I don't know if you know what that means from a fan's point of view. And like I said yesterday,
well,
13-year-old, and my first album I heard was Colors, and I was like, oh man, that is incredible.
You come as a planet stands.
You're very kind. Look, I got tired. That's not really true. I was going to say I got tired of dealing with surface. I got tired of dealing with surface in my own life. Of course, when I came to the Lord, it just, we're not talking about makeup. We're talking about plastic surgery and a heart transplant, man. We're, you know, I'm going to cut your arm off. There's a whole bunch of stuff needs to happen. And, but early on, Wendy and I, and most of us here, regardless, there are other people just like us running around out there, whether or not they ever had anything to do with the church, or they just finally, when the prodigal son came to himself. Interesting. The mirror showed up. So trying to reflect that in lyrics, trying to do music that you know, you're going to pay attention, or you're going to run out the door. You're going to listen, or you're going to close your ears and leave. You know, here it is. It's not for everybody, I'm not for everybody, and my delivery isn't. I mean, this is part of the deal. This paradigm, this perspectives. You know, this is the way to do. What Jesus is the way, you quoted it, John 14:6. So many different kinds of people, but the reality factors of the way people are just trying to survive, don't know any better. Paul talks about the chief of sinners, you know, but I did it in ignorance. Now we're right back to it, aren't we? And it's not just just education. I mean, biblical education about Jesus, the gospel, the scriptures, so on. I'm not talking just Bible college seminary. I'm talking, you know, knowledge, understand. But the humility of, this is who you are, dude. This is, dudette, you know, this is how you look. This is how you feel. I hear you. I get it. I've been there. I got it. Let's go for it. Let's talk about those issues. Let's not brush them under the rug and, you know, I'm okay, you're okay in Jesus. You know, when the church does that kind of stuff, it's not honest. And Jesus is the truth. Paul calls the church the pillar and ground foundation of the truth. And John, there's so many scriptures. Jesus said, sanctify them, set them apart from the rest of the world through the truth. Your word is truth. So there is a point where what is really true and what is really not true is important, and we're not going to always agree on that. I mean, the whole Christian church throughout the centuries has never all agreed on that. Everybody, literally of one mind, literally of one accord in the thinking processes, and there's a lot of reasons for that. Some of it's morals and ethics, some of it's education and ignorance, some of it's literacy and illiteracy and blah blah blah, social conditioning, your family life, the way your closest friends, you know, you got to kiss up to the Joneses, even though the Joneses might be going to hell. They're good church people, you know. So I've often said the second largest mission field in the world is the church. But when you're in the street, when you're dealing with the average person, the common people heard him gladly. Why? He didn't speak like the Pharisees, the religious big shots who wanted control, who had to have control and had to have the last word. My way or the highway, that whole attitude is so anathema to the he became poor that for our sakes that we might become rich. You know, I mean, there's an element of laying your life down to where you can actually begin to hear not nonsense, lies, demonic garbage, but hey, this is reality in this person's life. Write those kind of lyrics, you know, write that stuff in your blog book, preach that kind of message, listen, hang out, get to know, build a bridge, and just maybe they'll come to know that Jesus that you love and know. And that's really where we're coming from. That's where I'm coming from. So I don't have to kiss up to anybody for any of it, not in the church, not outside the church. I'm fighting for your sons and daughters, your grandkids, whether you know it or not. That's the issue.
Yeah, if I can just say on that point that you just made, when I was a teenager, I was the product of a broken home. My, you know, parents divorced when I was 3. So, you know, and listening to you tell your story earlier, I realized that mommy don't love daddy anymore is your story. And it connected with me as a teenager because I came from a similar kind of thing. And so exactly what you were just talking about reached me as a teenager. So, yeah.
Laura, I thank you for these brothers, and I thank you for the chance to follow you. You knocked on our doors, each one of us, in different, in some ways, similar ways. And may we be poor and yet make others rich. May my focus be on you. I want to ask right now for folks that are going to be showing up at this gig this evening, all kinds of people, all different places. Followers, atheists, agnostics, folks that are backslidden, that have made commitments to you, that don't follow you any longer. And they're going to be showing up because of a school, because they want to support financially and, you know, have a little party time, a little dance time, a little hangout and entertainment. And Lord, you know what you want to do in their heart. So I want to ask you to go before me and Amy and her band and everyone else going on, the rappers tonight. And thank you for the pastor over there and folks that really love you. And Lord, for these brothers, their interaction with their various churches and of course for 312, the whole podcast, would you just lead and guide? We so much want to spend and be spent for others' sakes. Oh God, would you put a fire in our hearts to reach out to the least of these in our own neck of the woods? To go beyond theory and discussion and even beyond music and lyrics. Your life through us, in Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you so much, Father God. Woo, amen.
Amen. Mr. Glenn, I know we got to look at the time here. Thank you, sir. It's been a privilege. Before you completely leave us, let me stop recording if you can. I need to ask one quick question. Thank you, everybody, for watching. Thank you, Mr. Glenn.
Studied my stuff, did it my way, hid myself from the light of day, pushed, shoved, tripped and fell, but dead man.